Hello viewers, nature versus nurture. This is one of the basic controversies in psychology regarding many aspects of human behavior, be it personality, abnormal behavior or intelligence. Today we will explore this debate which has been going on since many years and has swung from one extreme to the other and finally has come to rest somewhere in between. We will be examining the genetic and environmental influences on intelligence. Nature. When we speak about nature, we are referring to what we inherit or our genetic makeup. When we speak about nurture, we are referring to the environment and all the factors in the environment which shape human behavior. So, is intelligence inherited or is it as a result of the environmental factors? Since the early 20th century, many studies have been conducted which point to either nature or nurture, genes or environment. The pioneers of the intelligence movement maintained that intelligence is inherited. Over the years, gradually, however, it has become clear that both heredity and environment influence intelligence. Theorists and researchers continue to argue and debate vigorously because this issue of whether nature or nurture is responsible for intelligence has serious socio-political implications. Those who are for nature downplay the value of special education for underprivileged groups. They feel that a child's intelligence cannot be changed because a child's destiny cannot be altered. So they believe that all the money which is being spent on special education is not worth the effort. On the other hand, those who support the nurture hypothesis say that inherited characteristics are not necessarily unchangeable. They advocate that more funds should be allotted for special educational programs, remedial coaching, improved schooling in lower class neighborhoods, and college financial aid for the underprivileged. Now, let's look at some of the evidences for the influence of heredity on intelligence. And as whenever we talk of intelligence, we go back to Sir Francis Galton. He was the first person to study individual differences. He believed that intelligence was innate and it was the product of evolutionary forces. He coined the term eugenics and he believed that society should make all efforts towards improving its genetic material. In his book Heredity Genius, he outlined the fact that intelligence runs in families. One of the earliest family studies or pedigree analysis, as it is known, was carried out by Goddard in 1912. Though the study has consequently been found, the Kallikak family study subsequently has been found to be seriously flawed in its research methods, but this was one of the earliest studies. Goddard traced the descendants of a Russian soldier who had a relationship with a feeble-minded barmaid and then later came back and married a woman from a good respectable family. The two lines of descendants were both given the name Kallikak, which is a fictional name, and he found that the descendants of the feeble-minded woman, barmaid, suffered from low intelligence. They had problems of abnormal behavior and generally were not respectable members of society. Whereas on the other hand, the descendants from the other line were well settled and were doing well in whatever vocation they had chosen. Following this, another animal study, which was carried out by Robert Tryon and was based on selective breeding. It is not possible to carry out such studies on human beings, and therefore animal studies, the findings of which can be interpolated to human behavior. Robert Tryon set up an IQ test for rats, which consisted of maze running ability. He made rats run a maze, and based on their performance, he divided them into maze dull and maze bright rats. The maze dull rats were allowed to breed for several generations with other maze dull rats, and the same was done with the maze bright rats. And later, when their maze running ability was measured, it was found that the maze bright rats had become considerably brighter and the maze dull rats had become much more dull. So there were substantial differences in this selective breeding experiment. These were the two early studies which established the genetic influence on intelligence. It is very difficult to untangle the effects of nature and nurture in human beings. One of the best ways which nature provides for the study of these two influences are twin studies. The study of twins was pioneered by Sir Francis Galton. When we look at twins and we see that identical twins show more similarity in IQ than fraternal twins, we can assume that this is because of genes. Identical twins share the same genetic makeup, and therefore this similarity can be attributed to genes. The average correlation of identical twins is 0.86 as compared to the average correlation between fraternal twins that has been found to be 0.6. Of course, we can argue that this high correlation could be because the twins share an identical environment. So, a better idea would be to study twins who have been reared apart. If it is then found that in spite of being reared apart, they are very similar in their IQ, we can definitely say that this is because of genes. One of the most famous studies on twins reared apart was published by Cyril Burt, a Britisher. He studied 50 twins who were reared apart, and he could establish the fact that genes definitely influence intelligence. These findings played an important role in the evolution of the British educational system. Of course, later it was found that many of the results of this study were scientifically inaccurate, but nevertheless, they influenced the educational system in Britain. Apart from twin studies, there is another method which has been used to explore the role that genes and environment play in the intelligent behavior of human beings. Adoption studies look at the differences or similarities in IQ between the adopted child, the biological parents, and the adoptive parents. If the IQ of the adopted child is more similar to the biological parents, even when she has been brought up by the adoptive parents, then we can say with certainty that genes influence intelligence. But adoption studies have not given us very conclusive evidence. Some of them show that the IQs of adopted children closely resemble that of their adoptive parents. So these studies point both towards genes as well as environment. We will now look at some studies which have been carried out which point to the environmental influences on intelligence. And we will look at both environmental deprivation and environmental enrichment. The cumulative deprivation hypothesis suggests that children reared in impoverished environments experience gradual decrease in IQ levels. And this has been found to be true in many studies. On the other hand, children removed from impoverished environments and placed in enriched environments have shown increments in their intelligence levels as high as 10 to 12 IQ points. Let's look at two of the studies which have established this fact. In 1949, under the guidance of Skodak and Skiles, 13 retarded 2-year-olds were taken from an institution and placed under the care of a young woman who looked after them and gave them a lot of attention and stimulation. 12 children were left behind in the institution and looked after in the normal way. In 4 years, the children who were brought up by the foster mother showed a substantial IQ gain of 30 points. So from this we can see that the attention and stimulation which is provided in the environment can bring about an increase in levels of intelligence. Much later, in 1982, Hunt carried out a study in an Iranian orphanage. 11 children were given environmental enrichment, which consisted of caregivers paying a lot of attention and responding to them whenever they needed. The impact of this attention was dramatic. IQ levels improved substantially. So we can see here that impoverished environments create problems, and if these children can be removed and put in enriched environments, there are chances of improving their intelligence levels. A well-known study conducted by Ramey in 1984 and a follow-up study done in 1998 shows the influence of environment on intelligence. 111 children from low-income, poorly educated families were assigned to an intervention group. These children were given full year-round daycare along with medical and social work services. Within 3 years, there was an increase of 17 IQ points, and the average IQ among the 111 children was 101. Follow-up results suggested that the results of this enriched environment were long-lasting. Another method of establishing the environmental influence on intelligence is the home environment studies. These are elaborate, systematic assessments of the quality of the intellectual environment. And it has been found that there is an average correlation of 0.3 between children's IQ scores and the assessment of the home environment. So, what is it in this home environment that provides this stimulating environment and increase in intelligence levels? It has mostly to do with the behavior of the parents and their interactions with the children. Parents who encourage exploration, experimentation, and independence, who are warm, affectionate, and highly involved with their children, who provide diverse array of learning materials and play materials, who speak articulately and are interested in intellectual pursuits, who encourage their children to work hard in school and reward them for their progress, who emphasize achievement motivation and provide tangible assistance with homework, are found to be the parents of children who have high levels of intelligence. They themselves are role models to their children, which in turn helps them to reach their full potential of intelligence. Some of the environmental risk factors associated with low IQ are as follows. A child who is a member of the minority group, the head of the household is unemployed or is a low skilled worker, mother who has not completed high school, a family who has four or more children, father who is absent from the family, family which has experienced many stressful life events, parents who have rigid child rearing values, mother who is highly anxious and distressed, mother who has poor mental health or diagnosed disorder, and a mother who shows little positive affect towards the child. These are some of the risk factors which are correlated with low IQ levels. Schooling plays a very important role in the development of intelligence, and it has been found that children who attend school regularly and for long periods of time definitely show higher levels of intelligence than those who do not. Children who have been deprived of formal education for long periods of time show decreased levels in IQ. In fact, some children, if they are measured for IQ, show decreased levels of IQ during their summer break. So, schooling is very beneficial to the development of intelligence. Programs for raising intelligence, such as Head Start, have had little lasting effect. But for children in deprived environments, full-time daycare-based care and stimulation throughout the preschool years may have a very lasting positive effect in respect to intelligence. Another interesting study which establishes the environmental influence on intelligence are the birth order studies conducted by Zions. He observed that firstborns exhibit higher levels of intelligence. This was an observation which even Galton had made in the early 1880s. The birth order studies state that family size influences the amount of stimulation available at home. The firstborn gets the entire attention of the parents and he does not have to compete with any siblings for their attention. The secondborns and the subsequent children have to compete with the others and therefore they do not receive the same kind of environment that the firstborn had received and therefore they show lower levels of IQ. An interesting fact is that this trend is reversed after the seventh child. The eighth child shows higher levels of intelligence, again just like the firstborn, and the ninth even higher and the tenth even higher. Why this is, we still are trying to understand, but this is an observed fact. So now we have looked at some of the studies which establish the genetic basis of intelligence and many studies which provide evidence for the importance of environment in the development of intelligence. The pendulum has swung from one end to the other, but now we know that both genes and environment, nature and nurture interact to produce intelligence in human beings. Sandra Scar has given us a concept of reaction range, which explains the interaction of both these factors in intelligence. Heredity sets certain limits on intelligence, and environmental factors determine where individuals fall within these limits. Upper limits cannot be exceeded even when the environment is ideal, and extreme circumstances drag an individual to the lower limits. So, if we are born with genes for high intelligence, then we will exhibit highly intelligent behavior. But if we are put with these genes in an impoverished environment, we may not reach the upper limit which has been set by genes. No amount of stimulation can make a child go beyond the upper limit which is set by the genes. One of the controversies surrounding intelligence is the fact that it has been found that there are racial differences in intelligence. IQ for many minority groups are lower by 3 to 15 IQ points in the United States. Though people like Jensen have tried to show that this is because of racial differences, it could actually stem from a higher incidence of socio-economic and educational disadvantage that the minority groups are exposed to. These disadvantages include large families, single parent homes, fewer learning opportunities, poorer role models, poorer quality schools, malnutrition, and exposure to environmental toxins. Kamen has given us a very good analogy which explains between group differences in intelligence. The individual variations within a group are due to genes, but the variation between groups depends on the environment. He says that individual variation in corn plant heights within each group are because of genetic differences in the seed. So, also individual variations within the group in intelligence are due to the genes. The differences in average corn plant height between groups, the cause of which is the soil in which the plants were grown. Similarly, the difference in intelligence between groups is because of the environment. So, the more stimulating and the more enriched the environment is, the higher will be the intelligence of people and between the two groups. It has been observed that intelligence and performance on intelligence tests has improved over the years. This was first observed by Flynn, and hence the name the Flynn effect. This rise has been large and consistent. Flynn collected data from 20 nations and he found an increase in approximately 3 IQ points per decade since the 1930s. But since the 1990s, this rise has declined. We are still trying to understand the reasons for this decline. The generational changes that we see in intelligence have been variously ascribed to environmental causes such as improved education, nutrition, and healthcare. Human nature is shaped by a complex interaction of heredity and environmental factors. Twin, adoption, and selective breeding studies provide strong indication for the role of heredity in determining intelligence. Evidence from adoption, orphanage, birth order, and home environment suggests that environment is important. So, we can say that the debate is no longer nature versus nurture, but nature via nurture. So, now let us just sum up some of the findings from these various research studies. Genetics play a bigger role than does environment in creating IQ differences in individuals. Intelligence is affected by environment. Individuals are not born with fixed, unchangeable levels of intelligence. genetically caused differences are not necessarily irremediable. And it has been found that with better opportunities and better medical care, improved education, the IQ for different racial ethnic groups are converging.